Thanks for the organizer for having me here. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the infrastructure part. I'm Alex, the CTO of Temasys. We're providing a few services that I'm not going to speak about today. I'm just going to take you guys through the painful path we followed last year trying to build up a first scalable infrastructure, right? So this is what I'm going to speak about. Most of the people start from the reference code, so I'm going to start from there too, and there is a lot of reason why you should do that. Now, the reference code is good for one use case, but might not be good for others, so I'm going to put the scope around that and show how you can do it better and address the first real pain, which is going to be scalability. There's a lot of things on the infrastructure of a good WebRTC solution that are going to be left out of this presentation because it's only 20 minutes, but I'm still going to provide a list at the end of the point you might want to look at before you go into architecturing such a solution for yourself. All right, so the reference code. WebRTC is an API, so API are difficult to demonstrate. There is a reference implementation at webrtc.org where a lot of companies, including Mozilla, Google, MIPS, Intel, Vonage contributed to. It has the existing peer connection, all the APIs. It has an iOS version. It has an Android version with all the wrapping. So if you want to start somewhere, start there. It's working. And to be able to play with it, there is also a reference application for you to use that. As Tsari told you before, WebRTC is just an API. If you want a solution, you need to make a choice for the signaling. You need to make a few choices, need to provide a few servers, and that's exactly what appRTC does. So this is the drawing of appRTC. You have a stunt server provided by Google or by Mozilla, depending on which browser you connect to the website. There is a separate web server for the turn management for the load balancing and geographically loading for turn. There is a turn cluster, actually. Then you have the web server and the signaling server. The advantage of the appRTC is that it's hosted by Google App Engine, so it's very scalable. You don't have to think about how many instances. They're already taking care of that. You don't think about replicating the database or things like that. It's done for you. Now, there is a few problems about the reliability, though, and that's mainly on the signaling server, right? So appRTC is here to implement a very simple case, which is a one-to-one communication, and within that scope, it does the job very well, right? And if you find a mistake and you want to report a bug, the first thing you're going to be asked for is to try to replicate it with appRTC. That's where the maintenance job is done. Now, one of the problems, though, is that the signaling server is actually not a single signaling server, but is leveraging what is called the GAE channel API, and that is sometimes a little bit problematic. The access to the database induced delays, and up to our experiments, the GAE channel API is sometimes not reliable, and more than sometimes. So if you go into multi-party, for example, the first thing people want to do is to go from the one-to-one to the multi-party, then suddenly, there's a lot of things that go unpredictable. So this is a little drawing of what is happening behind the scene just for a handshake, right? So you have the caller and the callee for a one-to-one call. The add local stream, create offer, set local, that's the API you have in WebRTC. And in the middle, you have a signaling server exchanging a few signal, right? That is very, very order and timing sensitive. So if you start adding delays on one part or the other, and you don't do that exactly in order, exactly like that, things just don't go through, right? And the reference code, you can make it reliable, adding delays, adding database here and there, and this is what is done in appRTC. You have a cache for the message waiting if a message arrives out of order and things like that. But then the handshake is stretched up to 10 seconds. So we had a multi-party, a scalable solution based on that at one point, but waiting 10 seconds for things to happen is just not acceptable. So let's go for a little bit better. As was mentioned before, a lot of people just drop that signaling and go for something that is not GS-based. It's much more reliable. It's much faster, so you can achieve handshake under 1 second without a lot of effort, right, with almost all the SDK API out there. there is a huge ecosystem of plugin and modules and stuff you can put on your node to actually add very nice feature very easily. Now, the problem is you lose the scalability you had from Google App Engine, and you lose the maintenance as well. So you can put the maintenance on an API SDK vendor, if that's the route you want. But if you do it yourself, you will have to be very careful about the level of test and the security you want to provide with your infrastructure. So let's address that. What's the scalability problem, really? Most of the people will use Node.js, and we go for a public cloud, like, let's say, Amazon Web Services, right? If only because they're everywhere in the world. And if you want to address Asia, as we're based in Singapore, right, and where that's the fastest growing market, Amazon Web Services is the only one that will have 10 data centers all across Asia. Now, the problem with Amazon Web Services, for example, is they don't give you commitment on bandwidth. They're going to tell you low usage, medium usage, or high usage. So you start going there, and you start doing benchmark, and then you realize very quickly there are unwritten rules. The biggest and the newest instances will have preferential access to the bandwidth, right? And the big instances will have their own network adapter, so you can actually have replicable bandwidth, right? Otherwise, on the small instances, one day you have 50 gigabytes, the day after you have 10, you have the noisy neighbor effect. So you will go for the big instances and the newest one. Well, the second problem is you don't have in Amazon Web Services socket intensive instances, right? So they have CPU intensive, they have memory intensive, they don't tell you anything about bandwidth. What about socket intensive? A signaling server is something that will have a lot of sockets open and close, and they don't have really an instance that fit to that. Most people will use socket.io for the transport because it will provide you WebSocket, which is the best solution out there when it's available, and implement a fallback to XHR and other solution when it's not, right? So it's completely transparent and it's fantastic. The problem is it doesn't scale across CPU. So if you go for one of those big instances like the 8XL and you have 32 CPU, well, you're going to use only one CPU. So you get the bandwidth, but you're wasting most of your CPU power. Horizontal scalability is a problem. Everybody that play video games know that. You have to connect to the same server as your friend if you want to play with them. So there is a limit that is per server. What do you do when you want to have people that are chatting in the same room but spread across different server on your infrastructure? That's horizontal scalability. And finally, Node fails often, so you need to find a way to address that and to handle the downtime when you want to upgrade your backend, for example. So let's go into that. Socket.io 0.9 scales using a store. So for example, we use Redis, and I think that that's the best to achieve a low latency. But the problem is the store replicates the data object. So then all the instances of Node using that store will try to do the same thing. So you're not CPU scaling. You just replicate the load on every single one of your core. So you do several times the same thing. So socket.io 1.x specifically addressed that problem, right? It changed the way the store works. It's going to use the same store as an event bus. So each instance run independently of each other, and it's only handling the clients connected to them. That being said, they still all listen to all events, so two clients can be connected to separate instances and still speak to each other through the signaling server. So it's socket.io 1.0 solve the horizontal scalability and CPU scalability problem if you have a Node.js problem, right? The horizontal scalability can even be improved by using the business as usual reverse proxy load, but everybody that has a website and has load is using that. So just to mention, you can also improve by just putting NGX or HA, high availability reverse proxy in front of everything. Node zombification. So the problem with Node is failing quite often, right? And you have to be careful and be able to detect not only when it fails to bring it back, but also sometimes when you have a new version that you want to deploy on your infrastructure, you don't want to take the infrastructure down and cut existing conversation, for example, time for the deployment. So there are a few Node modules that are good for that. There is a Node cluster API, which is nice. There is forever, not forever, that actually going to monitor every instance of node running and bring them back up if they fail or terminate by themselves. But there is a new one, which is called PM2, which is even better than that. It does keep alive clustering and load balancing at the OS level, not at the instance level, log aggregation, terminal monitoring, and a lot of other magic that's going to make your life much, much, much easier, right? So there are other things to consider when you think about a WebRTC infrastructure, even though the scalability is really, really the pain point. Scalability for the signaling server, like I presented to you, is one way to approach it, but you're not going to scale a media server, an MCU, the same way, because it's going to be bandwidth intensive, because it's going to be CPU intensive. So every single piece of your infrastructure will have to have a different way of addressing the scalability issue, and you still need to keep the entire infrastructure coherent, right? So that's where the difficulty resides. You want to be careful about session management, authentication, usage, payment, but there are a lot of usual solutions that exist for that in the ecosystem that you can take out of the shelves, and you don't need to make different for WebRTC. Now, if you really, really want to go into the difficult part, turn server can be difficult to load balance. When you use appRTC, it's done a very smart way behind to put the secret outside the website, have security and load balancing at the same time. So you don't see it, and the source code for that has not been made available, so be careful. When you go out of appRTC, you will have to replicate that. And MCUs are really the things that are going to make a difference if you want to have more people in a given conference, and they don't scale the same way, right? Here it is. I don't know if we have time left, but apparently there is nobody behind me, so if anybody has questions, they're welcome. Questions? Is the middleware to handle turn server load balancing going to be made available?
Yeah, it actually is available.
The COE turn?
Yeah, the compute engine on demand. I think that's actually been open sourced. I'll talk about that a little bit later because I want to address.
Justin here, by the way. Say
hello, Justin. Oh, check.
You got microphone here. Mine up here. Number four.
What? So, Justin Uberti, tech lead for Google.
A proton walks into a bar. responding to the, we have a thing called Compute Engine on Demand, which actually is like a service that runs on App Engine that spools up turn servers running on Compute Engine on demand. And we have that code. It's actually open source. I'll go find a link to it so that the secret sauce that Alex is referring to, we can make it unsecret. Alex also mentioned the some of the issues with the actual channel API and message delivery. This has been a recurring nightmare for us as well. This stuff is all getting gutted, burned with fire, and rewritten so that it is going to be actually appropriately industrial strength. Based on Memcache, and we hope to have that soon. I'll talk more about that later.
All right, and GAE API for mobile, so I don't have to put a web view with a hack on JavaScript to be able to support.
Ask questions later.
Okay, fair enough.